challenges that we confront, just like everyone in this room in your respective industries has had to confront a changing world, a rapidly changing world. And whether you're in publishing or in politics or in law or in business, in each of your industries and endeavors, you've seen a world change at such a rapid pace, you can probably hardly believe it. And in truth, that's what we're seeing in criminal justice as well. And so what I want to talk about is how we are affecting innovation and change in our office in the various areas that confront us, although, as I said, it will only be a snapshot. And let me start, first of all, in talking about some of the most difficult cases and most important cases to me in an office which is focused on public safety, and that deals with violence and enhancing safety in our streets. And I'm going to focus specifically just in my remarks on gang violence and gun violence. Now, thankfully, I expect that for most of you in this room, gang violence and gun violence is not something that you confront. You read about it, but you really don't read about it enough because it is not covered by the papers to the degree that it should be covered to reflect the severity of the situation that we actually have. Now, that's not to say that we have not made huge strides thanks to the police department, thanks to my predecessors, and thanks to the broader law enforcement community to drive crime down to what really are historic lows. But let me just, to make the point, say that yesterday in our courthouse, we had a sentencing involving a shooting that occurred two summers ago in Harlem, where the victim was a 17-year-old girl innocently sitting on the stoop with her family and her friends when she was shot to death in crossfire in a Harlem community on a sunny August afternoon in 2010. The week before that, there was a sentencing and a conviction after 3 years of investigation in our office of a 13-year-old boy who'd been shot in central Harlem in 2009. And the case took 3 years to bring to trial because there was intimidation, among other things, of witnesses in the community by gang members preventing people to come forward, behavior in the courtroom. And what we see, my point is, that even in this era of highly reduced crime, there's too much gang violence and there's too much gun violence. And the question is, as a DA, how do you deal with this in a proactive manner other than looking for someone else to solve the problem for you? And that was the challenge that I took on when I was elected as DA, and I want to tell you a little bit about how we're focusing on this, and it relates to the issue of innovation. What I decided to do was open up a unit within the office called the Crime Strategies Unit. And the Crime Strategies Unit is focused on proactive intervention by our office, leaning forward into crime issues as opposed to waiting for the police to bring cases to our office by way of summary arrest. And we work very closely with the police department and with the communities. But this unit essentially is an intelligence unit within the DA's office. And let me tell you why that's important. With 100,000 cases a year, you have an enormous amount of information and intelligence that comes to our office through every case. Some of them may be related to credit cards. Some of them may be related to drug cases. Some of them may be related to sexual assault. Some may be related to gang violence. But hitherto, the information that we collect in these cases has never been centrally organized or shared within an office of 535 lawyers. But what we see again and again and again is the defendant in your case involving a subway fare evasion may be a critical witness in someone else's homicide case in another bureau in another part of the office. And the point is to try to gather information that had previously been kept on 10,000 legal pads scattered in the office of 535 lawyers in an office in two buildings in a way that we can centrally access and share information so that as cases come into our office and as information develops, we can utilize it. We can utilize it to help build other cases, to make other cases stronger, to open investigations as opposed to treating each case as a single entity which you handle, resolve, and move on, and its only value is within its four corners. And so, on a regular basis, our crime strategies DAs meet with me, and they look with me on a map, and our goal is to identify who is driving crime in each of the precincts in Manhattan, and that's not very hard to figure out. a small number of people cause a disproportionate amount of crime. But you have to understand who they are, and then you have to have a strategy to deal with them when they come back into the criminal justice system. And so we do that by working with the precincts, the command in all the precincts, by working with the community, and we are able simply to know who the principal drivers of crime in many of the neighborhoods are. And when they come into our system now, and because these are repeat offenders, they often do, we actually get alerts in our office, like a Google alert. And so my assistant in the crime strategies unit will be able then to speak directly with the assistant who's writing the case up in the complaint room in Lower Manhattan and say, you know, this individual is coming in. Now, it may be for a minor charge, but this is someone we need to pay attention to. This is his or her background. This is what you need to tell the judge at arraignment as to why this case is more significant than it might otherwise appear on the face of the papers. And this is what you ought to be asking for in terms of bail. And this is what you ought to be asking for in terms of recommendation for sentence. And when you have that kind of specific focus on the crime drivers, you're then able to treat those cases individually with the seriousness that they deserve, as opposed to letting them slip through the cracks. And time again, we find that that strategy works. Now, you'll tell me if I'm going on too long, but let me give you just one example, because this has all probably happened to you or you've heard of it. This is sort of a minor example, but it shows why it's important. There's all sorts of people who walk around the streets engaged in what they call fraudulent accosting. And that's when I bump into you in the street, I drop my glasses, which had previously been broken, and I say, you broke my glasses, you knocked into me, and it's going to cost me $200 to replace the glasses. Give me $200. And hundreds of times a year in this community, people shell over $200 because they're intimidated by these people who accost them on the street. Now, is this the crime of the century? Of course not. But let me tell you the story about one individual whose name I'll just leave blank, who had been convicted more than 50 times for similar offenses. He'd never done any significant prison time. The most time he'd ever done in jail was 5 months. Again and again and again, he was intimidating people in central Manhattan of all sizes and stripes and ethnicities and from different places. And no one was ever taking his cases seriously. Well, he got on our list of people to focus on. He got arrested for doing exactly what I described. Our complaint room was notified. They decided to write it up as a robbery instead of a misdemeanor fraudulent accosting, because what he had really done was intimidate someone in order to get them to give him money by threatened use of force. So it was written up as a robbery as opposed to a misdemeanor fraudulent accosting. Bail was set. He was kept in jail. The judge paid attention to it. He decided he wanted a trial. He got his trial. He got his trial, got convicted, and is now doing 2.5 years to 7 in state prison for what would have previously been treated as a relatively minor misdemeanor by perhaps our office and the court system. And if you do that with the right people again and again and again, you're going to have an impact on those people who are driving crime in each of our neighborhoods. And that's an example of intelligence-driven prosecution. Another example is focusing on places where crime is rising and making sure that our assistants are focused on strategies to take out the individuals, and I mean take out in the legal sense, the individuals who are behind that violence. And let me give you one example of this. In central Harlem on 137th Street, right in the shadow of the Abyssinian Church, surrounded by some of Harlem's most important landmarks, was a block that had been held in a state of siege for years by warring gangs, buying drugs, selling drugs, enforcing their territory with shootings, recruiting boys and girls under 16 to move the guns and the drugs because they were less susceptible to being stopped by the police. Now, it came to my attention by virtue of our crime strategies DAs, because I was seeing that in the years before we started paying attention to it, there had been 14 shootings, including homicides, in this location. And so we decided, as we are doing analogously in many other places in Manhattan, to put a team of DAs on this hotspot to identify who's behind the violence, build cases against them, indict them, and remove them from the territory. And that's what we did. Now, the important statistic here to me is not related to the effort in building the case, which took more than a year and took a lot of effort and cooperation with the NYPD, who I tip my hat to for the great work they do with us every day, and to my assistants for their imagination and their diligence. But when we indicted that crew, in the year since that indictment, since February 2012, everybody has now pleaded guilty, all 14. The most significant crime drivers are doing significant state time, as is appropriate because they were running this organization for years. The younger players who had not been in trouble before got sentences that reflected that they are individuals who deserve a second chance to get back into life and on with their life and to find their way going forward. But it's the fact that in the year after the indictment until today, there's only been one shooting in that same area. So we went from 14 in the preceding 2 years to one. And we did that not just because we put the people in jail. We did that because once the case was taken down, we worked aggressively with the community, as Kim was talking about, to make sure that we were providing, with the help of the city council, internships for the neighborhood kids so they could get appropriate access to seeing what's out there in the world and opportunities for them in their lives. We worked in terms of neighborhood cleanup. We worked in terms of community outreach by our community affairs assistants and with the police department. And it's that partnership after the fact that has enabled us, at least in that neighborhood, in this period of time, to go from 14 to one. One is too many, but one is a heck of a lot better than 14. And you take that model neighborhood by neighborhood, and that's what we're trying to do with proactive, intelligence-based prosecution strategies to try to make each of the neighborhoods in Manhattan safer. And if you're reading the papers, and probably not the papers you're reading, you'll see that we've done this same model in 8 or 10 other cases around Manhattan in the last 18 months. So this is a strategy, a new ways to approach an old problem using teamwork, coordination between community, prosecution, and NYPD, using all our technological tools, and then follow up with intervention, all kinds of intervention, because I subscribe to the words that were spoken by former Police Director McCarthy of Newark, New Jersey, who's now head of Chicago's Police Department, that the goal here is when you take the beach, you want to keep it. And that means that once you've done your law enforcement action, you need to fill in community action and engagement to make sure that you do everything you can that it doesn't slip back. So the second area of innovation I'll talk about is indeed related to cybercrime. Kim talked about it, holding up his PDA. Another way for me to say it is the internet is the crime scene of the 21st century. Every case we have, literally, across the spectrum, from the most modest to the most serious, involves electronic communications, Facebook, Twitter, movements of material on the internet. In our office, as existing as it does in the center, in the hub of international commerce and finance, has to be proficient in dealing with cybercrime and cyber threats. And increasingly, we are. We've opened up a cybercrime bureau in the Manhattan DA's office. It now has 10 full-time assistant district attorneys who work on cases involving national and transnational cybercrime, identity theft, and cyber fraud. We work in very close cooperation with our brethren in the federal government, both our U.S. attorney partners, as well as Secret Service, Treasury, ICE, and all the other federal agencies, in addition to the NYPD. It is a true partnership effort. And the scope of these cases is enormous. Many relate to large-scale identity theft, rings that sometimes operate offshore, introducing malware into computers onshore and recruiting local actors to help move money that has been stolen into new bank accounts or monetizing information that's been stolen, such as social security numbers and credit card numbers, creating false credit card numbers and checks and monetizing that which has been stolen and then using it to get it into their own bank accounts and get it back offshore. So this is a big endeavor for us, and we have to be competent. The federal prosecutors are great at this, but there's too much of this work to do to simply rely on federal prosecutors to get it all done. So I will tell you that cybercrime is the fastest growing crime trend, I believe, in the country. It is certainly the fastest growing crime trend in the county of New York. It's increased about 50% identity theft and cybercrime over the last 5 years. It is a full court press from our office, and I believe it will continue to be really our among our highest priorities. We've had to open up our own cybercrime lab to deal with accessing information and forensic evaluation of cell phones and computers and the like, because we're doing so many of these cases at such a complex level that we simply can't rely on outside agencies anymore to get the work done in the time frame in which we need it done in order to move the investigations forward. And many of these cases, as I say, relate to some of the things that are financial. Last year, we also indicted 35 individuals for trading in images of child sexual abuse involving defendants both here and around the country. This is not child porn. This is not pornography. These are actually shared images of children being abused sexually. Very young, incredibly young boys and girls. And so we have to, as an office, be prepared to handle financial crimes, to handle the more gruesome cases like I just described. We have to be able to do it, and I think, in fact, we are. 2 weeks ago, I returned from Israel for my second trip in 2 years to Israel. And it's a fair question, what does the Manhattan DA have to do in Israel? And why is the Manhattan DA visiting Israel? Well, I'm going to start with cybercrime, and then I'm going to talk about terror funding. But I went to Israel for many reasons. Number one, we have developed a good working relationship with the head of RSA, which is one of Israel's high-tech companies, that is one of the experts in cyber fraud and protecting corporations and just cybersecurity nationwide and internationally. And to talk with Dr. Orna Berry, who was at one point Israel's chief scientist, about the work that she was doing and finding ways that we can partner with them about helping us do a better job in the Manhattan DA's office. And it's another example of innovation and partnership, which is not news to any of your businesses. There's lots of smart people in New York City. I could probably go up and down the elevator banks here and meet some of the smartest people in the world. So we don't have to go far often to get good advice. But sometimes it's important, and I learned this from living on the West Coast for nearly two decades, that actually there's a lot of smart people elsewhere in the world who can teach us something in New York about how to do a better job here. And even a couple in Seattle tucked, who are moonlighting as grunge band rockers. But the point is that sitting down with Dr. Orna Berry and talking about our challenges here and getting her advice and getting her guidance prospectively, as I believe we will going forward, is a great opportunity and reflects how important it is for us to constantly be open to new ideas so that we can do a better job. But the second purpose that I visited Israel for was to help us in our work related to interruption of terrorist financing and funding. And now this is an enforcement priority of our office that we've been doing for 4 to 5 years now. It started with my predecessor, it's continued under me. Bottom line is that we have banking rules and regulations and United States laws that indicate that certain individuals and entities who are associated with terrorism or other sanctioned activities and are no longer permitted to be doing business with the United States or entities and individuals within the United States shouldn't be. And those sanctions have to mean something and be enforced or they're meaningless. And our office has taken a strong stand with our federal partners to make sure that those sanctions are enforced. In our cases in the last 2 years with foreign banks who have settled the cases with us after investigations, the interesting byproduct is it's brought back to the city of New York in that same two-year time period $400 million in penalties, fines, and forfeitures. Now, my budget's $80 million a year. If you can find another public agency that in a two-year period has returned five times its budget, you let me know, because I'd like to invest in it. But it's not the money that matters. The money grabs headlines, and the money is relevant. But it is the fact that now banking institutions and commercial institutions around the world understand that if they are going to risk doing business with individuals or entities that are on the federal government or the EU sanctions list, and they're barred from doing business with the United States, they're barred from moving money through our money systems, then people are actually going to do something about it, and it's not going to be ignored. And it was one of the reasons we were able to actually indict the Iranian national shipping lines in 2010 for doing just that. It was barred from doing business with the United States in 2008 because of its association with terrorism and moving money and materiel associated with terrorism. But what the Iranian national shipping lines did was simply create alter ego companies and dummy companies and do the same business. Working with our intelligence partners, we built a case over 2 years. We indicted the Iranian shipping lines for violating the sanctions in partnership with our federal partners. Now, do I expect the head of the Iranian shipping line to show up for court in New York? Candidly, I doubt it. But the point is that insurers and other people who might be otherwise inclined to do business with the Iranian shipping lines are going to think twice about doing it, knowing that laws prohibit them from doing it as long as they're going to access the U.S. financial system. And so the import of these cases, when you're talking about terror funding, is to make sure that sanctions that exist for a reason, a good reason to protect all of us, that they're enforced. And our work in the Manhattan DA's office is actually important in this area. And again, we will continue to do more. Now, I know that's a lot of fire-breathing talk from a prosecutor, but I think I also would like to talk before I end on some very hopeful notes about the work that we do focusing on crime prevention. I think everyone around this table would agree with me. If we could prevent a crime from occurring, we'd much rather have that as an outcome than prosecuting a crime once it's occurred. And so I believe, as the Manhattan DA, that we ought to be investing carefully but aggressively in crime prevention strategies. And I do this because it relates to making the city safer. And if it makes the city safer, I think we ought to use our tools in our office to figure out what role we can play in this regard. One of the things we did in the last 8 months is to focus on where high school, where gyms were closed in parts of Manhattan, and to work toward opening those gyms on Friday and Saturday nights between the hours of 5 and 9 p.m. when kids are most at risk, for kids who are 12 to 18 years old, which is the high risk group, in order to provide for them a safe place to be on those high-risk nights and high-risk hours. And that's, frankly, the most frequently asked request I get from parents around the county when I'm visiting neighborhoods around the county is, our development doesn't have the resources for play space at the needed times for our kids, and can you help? And most of my work is done in a courthouse downtown, but increasingly I see the value of our work is in the communities. So what we did was we started to take money that we had seized from drug cases and take those drug seized forfeiture assets and invest them in sports programming in the various locations around Manhattan that we were focused on. We focused first at the Powell Center at 119th Street and Manhattan Avenue. And we hired a group called Pro Hoops. Pro Hoops is a professional basketball training program. Not only are they great men and women, but they're phenomenal trainers. And the key to all of this is good programming. If you go into a neighborhood and it's me trying to show someone how to play basketball or shoot hoops, it doesn't work. But if you bring in world-class training that everyone knows they're getting the same kind of trainers that the people in this room would hire for their own kids if they wanted them to be on the varsity or to be in the pros, they're getting the best of the best. The kids respond to it. Not only that, they get mentorship. Not only that, they're working together as a teamwork, in teamwork, as opposed to taking their beefs out on the street. They're taking their beefs out on the courtroom floor, which is where we want it to be done. And it was so successful in Central Harlem that we opened up another Saturday and Friday night program in the Lower East Side at the Henry Street Settlement. It was so successful in the Henry Street Settlement that we opened up another program in the Johnson Houses in East Harlem. And it's so successful there that we hope to be opening another program in northern Manhattan at the Polo Grounds this summer. Now, about 1,000 kids have signed up for this program over the last 8 months in that age group. And we don't have 1,000 kids who show up every Friday and Saturday night. But if we can have 150 kids on each Friday and Saturday night in Central Harlem, another 150 in the Lower East Side, 200 in East Harlem, and another 100 in northern Manhattan, that's a level of scale of positive, productive activity and a good engagement with the law enforcement community, because cops are involved in this, DAs are involved in this, the families are involved in this. that is where we are investing some of our money as a crime-fighting strategy. And it's not only in that regard. I think we always have to be open and self-evaluate about whether the job and the tools we're utilizing are the best ones to get the job done. And it's why I was up in Albany yesterday with Governor Cuomo and spoke at the conference that he held there to in support of a law that would decriminalize marijuana in small amounts outside of the pocket. It's not a crime if you have a small amount of marijuana in your pocket, but it becomes a crime if you take it out of your pocket. Same amount. So it's a difference between 1 inch. Crime, no crime. That doesn't really make any sense. And the impact is felt on about 6,200 people a year in Manhattan who are arrested for possession of marijuana in plain view out of the pocket. 50% of those have never been arrested before. Roughly 85 to 90% are typically young men and women of color. And 50% are between the ages of roughly 16 to 24. Now, if I can take the same resources that we were using to prosecute those cases and move them to prosecuting serious violent crime elsewhere in Manhattan, that's a better investment of my resources. And so from a law enforcement standpoint, it makes sense to support that kind of fair and common sense change in the law. And by the way, I also think it's the right thing to do. So the work we do, Kim, in the DA's office today crosses the board. I haven't even touched on hate crimes, on elder abuse, on domestic terrorism, on homicides, on domestic violence, which is probably one of the biggest priorities that I have in my office, and we hope to build a family justice center in Lower Manhattan in 2013 to provide the best services possible for victims of domestic violence. So I've really talked about 10% of the work of the office. Hope you'll forgive me, but time only permits me to do so much. But I wanted to come here today. I wanted to come to talk to you because you care about Manhattan. I care about Manhattan. The work that my assistants are doing day in and day out in Manhattan, I think, is extraordinary. They are enormously dedicated. They are thinking outside the box. They don't do this for money. They do it because they love the work. They do it because they think prosecutors can really make a difference in improving the lives of every community that we're privileged to serve. I believe the same thing, and that's why I wanted to come and talk to you today. And with your permission, I'm happy to take questions.
But let me call on the people. But I want to ask, not the first question, but I'm going to ask Cy, because at the risk of appearing chauvinistic, but there are a number of women in this room who said to me, thank goodness for Cy Vance. And these were people who have been fans of him, of his, as long as I have. And so I would ask you, and I'll put it in the form of a question, and for those of you who want to know about the button that I'm wearing, I'll tell you about that later. But I would like Cy to talk about the groundbreaking work that he has done, briefly, not too briefly, in the areas of domestic violence, and why people like Gloria Steinem, who also spoke at the Common Good, think that he is God's gift to women, not just in Manhattan, but all over this state and this country because of the groundbreaking work that he is doing in that area.
Let's just start with domestic violence briefly and then move more broadly, because some of the most difficult cases we have to handle in a DA's office relate to allegations of sexual assault, and domestic violence as a subset often of that same issue. Domestic violence, it became clear to me, had to be a high priority of our office because the numbers weren't going down. While violent crime numbers have declined, thankfully, incidences of reported domestic violence have basically stayed at a level or gone up over the last few years. We clearly need to be doing more and doing a better job to deal with this very difficult crime issue. Difficult because it involves intimate partners, it involves complex personal dynamics, it involves kids, it involves a special skill set in terms of patience in dealing with this victim group, survivors of domestic violence. So we've reorganized our office to have domestic violence now part of what we call a special victims bureau, which encompasses child abuse, elder abuse, domestic violence, sexual assault. And the reason we have it under a special victims bureau now and under unitary leadership is because the issues between these type of cases transcend them. A domestic violence case may also be linked to a case of child abuse or some other crime dynamic in the family. So there is an interdisciplinary approach to handling these kinds of cases, which benefits by a reorganization and single leadership of this unit. It was my priority in running for office that we would have a family justice center in Manhattan, a family justice center, and I'm probably preaching to the choir of knowledgeable here, but it is a concept that was actually started in San Diego decades ago, where victims of domestic violence were able to take their cases and have the full range of their issues dealt with in one place, as opposed to being bounced around from agency to agency, place to place, room to room, over weeks to weeks. So in a single place, one can speak with the police, speak with prosecutors, get social service and city help, and that's designed to give domestic violence victims, who often have to show enormous courage to just get out of the relationship that they're in, to make sure that they are given a more holistic, complete level of support that is managed out of one place as opposed to out of 10 places, which is enormously frustrating for anybody who has to deal with going from agency to agency. So that is something that we hope to have operational in 2013. The preliminary work has started now in terms of construction, but these things take time, and while we have initial funding for construction, we obviously need to get operational funding going forward. But I thank the City Council, the Borough President, and the Mayor for supporting, and we have skin in the game ourselves. We put our own money in the Manhattan DA's office into the construction of this facility. But just to talk about challenges and innovation in this area, which isn't really related to domestic violence, but is related to the issue of violence against women, is not too long ago, about maybe a month ago, we indicted a sex trafficking case in Manhattan. And it was interesting for a couple of respects. Number one, we indicted, I believe that in sex trafficking, what you have is, what you really have is a business. And the business relies upon supply, who are the traffickers, delivery, in this case, the limousine drivers who would move the prostituted women around to various locations in the city, and you have demand, which in this case were Johns. And when you're dealing with sex trafficking, you really have to deal with all three areas. And it's controversial to deal with all three areas. But in this case, we used all the tools that we typically use in a business investigation. We used wiretaps. We used sophisticated financial investigative techniques in order to be able to seize vehicles and bank accounts, which were the economic engine for the operation of the trafficking organization. We indicted suppliers, the delivery vehicle, the drivers, as well as with misdemeanors, I think 14 Johns who were charged with patronizing a prostitute. And that is a approach to sex trafficking that I think is appropriate given the nature of the offense. And we did not charge any of the prostituted women in this area. And we took the case investigated as wiretaps so that we had communications memorialized, knowing that we needed essentially an evidence-based case to build, because many of the individuals, like domestic violence survivors, are going to be very difficult for them to come back to court and want to participate in a courtroom proceeding down the road. So this is an example of just a change in practice, a change in investigative technique that we are applying not just in domestic violence but in sex trafficking, and that's how law enforcement is evolving, as is our office, to do a better job in these very, very difficult cases.
And now you know why we love Cy Vance so much. Now let me just, and if you could, Bill Hubbard?
The crime prevention programs you described in Harlem, East Harlem, and downtown was very impressive. And do you interface with a city agency on those programs? And are any of the other DAs in the other boroughs duplicating that?
What we are doing in terms of the Crime Strategies Unit is, I think, unique. It's unique in the sense structurally, what we have done is we've divided the county up into five zones. I've assigned a senior trial attorney, former trial attorney, to be the point of light, point of contact for each one of those zones between the community and law enforcement and myself. And it's their job to know building by building, block by block, neighborhood by neighborhood, what are the crime trends and what's happening, and also to work with our community affairs in terms of intervention on these prevention programs. So the structure is really quite unique, although prosecutors' offices all over the country have some varying elements of the same thing. The only city agency that we really interface with is NYCHA. And Chairman Rea and I and our office are working ever more closely to, for example, in the Johnson Houses, which is a NYCHA development, to figure out how we can identify areas where these kinds of crime prevention strategies and youth programming strategies, where we can support his work. A lot of the gang activity, a lot of the youth activity stems from developments. It stems from youth crews who are senselessly fighting each other based upon territorial devotion to a development, one versus another. So we do want to work and do work very closely with NYCHA in that regard. Obviously, we work very close with the NYPD, another big city agency. And I stay in close touch, quite honestly, with the criminal justice coordinator for the mayor, John Feinblatt, and keep the mayor in the loop as well. There's a partnership with city agencies, but we don't have an official partner, so to speak. This really was a Manhattan DA office initiative, but we're looking for partners, and we're not trying to be exclusive. I mean, we want partners to help us expand what we're doing, and any opportunity that makes sense, we'll explore.
Are you using the restorative justice model at all in juvenile cases?
I'll tell you where we are using the restorative model that I know is in hate crime cases.
It is a
model that really looks to how the victim is interested in having, you can correct me, how the victim is interested in having the case resolved, looking toward what the victim feels is the best resolution in a way that satisfies the victim's desire for closure, as opposed to the criminal justice system's desire for accountability, deterrence, and punishment. In the hate crimes arena, we have, for cases where hate crimes are under investigation and been charged, actually done just that, gone to the victims, and we've interfaced with the Anti-Violence Project and other, it's been particularly in the LGBT community, we have worked with them to try to find alternate resolutions to those cases using a restorative justice model. I know that we are doing it probably to a degree that I'm not even, a larger degree than I'm aware, in issues of domestic violence. Clearly, domestic violence, our main focus is on the survivor and what she wants, typically she, you know, what is the best outcome for her, even if that is independent from a criminal prosecution. I mean, what is it that enhances her safety? It's not really a restorative justice model, but it's very much our focus. In terms of kids, I'm sure we are. I just don't know if we have a restorative justice hat on a program. I will tell you that I'm co-chair of the State Sentencing Commission along with Judge Kamens, and we started our work about a year ago at the request of Chief Judge Lippman. We have proposed to the state legislation to raise the age of criminal responsibility from 16 to 18 for nonviolent felony offenses and misdemeanor offenses. So the family court model, which focuses on adjustments, which is another word to finding a way, you know, how is the victim satisfied, finding a way not to have it go into the criminal justice system for those nonviolent and lower level crimes, so to speak, would be promoted. And we actually, without getting too much into detail, what we propose is actually keeping those in the current criminal court system, but having the courtrooms essentially operated using family court adjudications and resources. We can't send 25,000 cases to the family court system. They just can't handle it. They don't have enough judges to begin with. So we're trying to do family court work in the criminal courthouse by having judges wear a family court hat and having access to probation and other more restorative justice type services for young boys and girls.
I was just going to suggest that I think it's a good idea. You could even use mediation, and that way juvenile defendants can take ownership of what they've done, understand what they've done, and possibly restore something to the community as well.
Well, we do actually participate in the youth court in Harlem, and the youth court is a situation where for low-level offenses with first-time and second-time offenders, they are actually judged by their peers, and the sanctions are community sanctions. Community sanctions and low-level offenses, I think, make a lot of sense because the community owns the solution. It's a risk because if it goes off the rails, the community may be blamed, we may be blamed for not being tough enough, but I do think that community sanctions as a concept make a lot of sense.
Excuse me, all the way in the back.
What do you think companies like Facebook and Google should be doing to help you solve cybercrime?
Well, we have an interesting debate with Twitter right now over access to subpoenaed materials, and I think it's being litigated, Alan, right now in court. So I'll make sure I'm appropriately polite, but I think that the answer to your question is really raised. It's really a fascinating question. The banking arena, just think of how, as industries grow up, they have to appreciate that they are being used from time to time for crimes and illegal purposes, hopefully unwittingly. And they have to evolve to a way that they can actually communicate with law enforcement and support legitimate law enforcement requests for information. So banks now spend, there's probably bankers in this room, you probably spend hundreds of millions of dollars a year if you're Citibank or JP Morgan in terms of anti-money laundering compliance, subpoena compliance, and the like. It is a huge amount of the work you do. And they understand that with that growth, with that volume of work that you do, you're going to interface with all sorts of people. Information is going to be subpoenaed, and you have to deal with the federal government and the state government, let alone all the civil requests. Then you've got this generation of new businesses, and as if they've gone from 1 year old to 25 years old in 2 years, and they've had to mature in an accelerated time frame. And the question is whether or not they are appreciating that their responsibilities as they become a 25-year-old in a 2-year-old body are those of a 25-year-old. When you're the medium for billions of communications around the world on a real-time basis, and those communications are from time to time going to be very relevant to law enforcement action or investigation, there has to be a responsible way for law enforcement to access that information and for those young companies to provide it. So what I would say, Alan, is I think that that the bigger question is, as these companies grow up, and I don't mean that pejoratively, as they expand their businesses and become communication tools for the world, as Facebook has, they have to deal with us. Facebook is a key investigative tool for our office. People do, you know, they go out and commit a crime, and they do the silliest things on Facebook once they've done that. You know, pictures of themselves with the proceeds of the crime, or weapons, or you name it, or communicating about it. But these, we communicate now electronically. I'd be interested to know when the last time anyone in this room actually signed a hard copy letter. But I can tell you, it's been a while for me. And I'm a hard copy letter fan. So this is how people are communicating, and because this is how people are communicating, we are, as law enforcement, having to deal with it every day. Cyberbullying, cybercrime, Facebook is the key medium.
I will do one more. That very patient young man back there, okay? But this has to be the last. This has to be the last question, unfortunately. Okay.
Russell Brandon from BuzzFeed. I noticed when you were talking about sort of the new cyber crimes, sort of the new focus on identity theft, and I was wondering if, I mean, obviously, sort of there are time constraints. Is that the primary focus of the cyber crimes you're looking at, or are there other ones that you sort of just have time to go into? I mean, would it be accurate to say it was?
Well, identity theft is probably the highest volume that we deal with, because we have probably 200 to 300 new identity theft cases that come into our office each month by way of street arrests. And historically, stop me if I'm repeating myself here, but historically we would have processed those as sort of one-off cases, a stolen credit card or passing a forged check. But what we find now is that, for example, the case that involves a stolen wallet in a gym locker in the Lower East Side may well be related to a stolen wallet from a gym locker in the Upper West Side. And so every day our cybercrime and identity theft assistant DAs, they scan and review the complaints and the online information we have about our new cases to just not look at the tip of the iceberg, but to look below the waterline and to find the connections between these cases which previously aren't always connected. And we find these connections all the time, and one of them involved an organized group of thieves stealing from gym lockers. The more complicated, and by that I mean in hacking, international identity theft rings and the like, we also are doing those investigations are long, complicated, often involve federal agencies. So short answer to your question is, we're doing both. Identity theft takes up the largest piece of the pie, but identity theft slips into more complex cybercrime very quickly as it expands to a bigger volume of intrusion of computers and the like.
So I know there are so many more questions, and Patricia texted me on electronic media. She is so sorry that she could not be here today, because she was so looking forward to hearing you. And as I said, Patricia is one of many who are big fans of Cy Vance. So on behalf of Patricia, on behalf of everyone at the Common Good, and I'm sure on behalf of all of you, I just want to thank you, and I hope that you will all be coming again to hear our next speakers. I think the next one is Todd Gitlin the next one, who I know from our radical days back in college, and now we're all part of the establishment, but he'll tell you about that. And then keep on coming and keep the civil discourse going. Thank you very much.